truth. Just as long as my heart beats, I must answer yes to love. Disappointment pierced me through, still I kept on loving you. If they ask what I did best, tell them I said yes to
love. For our message for all this morning, we're going to play another little game called This Is A... And we are going to fill in the blank. This is a... But it won't be what you think it is. Shall I begin?
Yes, please.
This is a way to strengthen the spirit. One, first principle. Second principle. Third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth principle. Ah.
This is a cup full of the world's wisdom. Glug, 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 glug.
I know what this is. This is a 70th anniversary birthday hat.
This is an old-time telephone full of good communication. Hello, hello, is anyone there? Can you hear me? Where's that Studebaker?
This is also a seashell in which we can hear our ancestors. Okay, Grandma, I will.
This is a rolling pin for some very, very thick dough.
This is a way to see my reflection upside down, reminding me that I still have a lot of questions.
It's also a way to see far away. Check out those stars. They're really, really old. A little hard to see them through the ceiling. But they're there. They're always there, whether or not we can see them. One more.
This is a way to catch raindrops and to use them to nourish, mix together, and create community and sustenance.
This is a chalice, the symbol of Unitarian Universalism.
And this is me going out to help the children in their classes.
I invite you now to join me in holding in our hearts the joys and sorrows of those around us. Close your eyes and go inward if you're comfortable doing so. Today, some woke with a sorrow so great they asked the help of our community to carry it. Others woke with a joy so great that it must be shared. Let me begin by lifting up the memorial services and the celebration of life that have graced our sanctuary this month. Yesterday, we gathered to remember Meredith Fahey, a beloved member of our community. Now this year we're celebrating our 70th year of USNH's existence. In so many ways, those memorial services are a celebration of our past. I just want to share with you my joy at seeing Reverend Kathleen Matigue again. Now, she was our former minister from 1991 to 2012, and she returned to assist in Meredith's service. The Korth family wants to express their deep appreciation to Joan Ciano and Jesse Grice for the fantastic rendition of These Are the Days, and their appreciation to Reverend Linda Susan for her inspiring words at Lindsay's memorial service earlier this month. Kathy Gardner shares that she and David are moving away to Central Ohio in October. She writes that the move is a joy because she's heading home, and a sorrow because she will solely miss his congregation, and we will miss her. Pat and Paul Trotter are delighted to be settled into their new home. They're going to be living with their adult children, Sue and Bill, in their upstairs apartment, where now they're a blended family of eight, plus four cats and a dog. And Patricia Duff is having hip surgery on the 27th of September, that would be this week, and would appreciate words of encouragement via cards, emails, or texts. For the joys and sorrows that have not been spoken, but which remain in the silent sanctuaries of our hearts, we bear witness.
I also want to name the memorial service for Marty Liptick that happened a few weeks ago, and that coming this coming Saturday will be the memorial for John Pollock. We've had many losses, and we hold them all in our hearts and with each other. I invite you into a time of meditation, prayer, or contemplation of ultimate things. This is a time when it's hard to know what comes next, how to respond to the questions that life brings up, hard to know where we will be in terms of our safety, hard to know what to expect. I invite you to breathe, though, into the things you do know, the people you love, the communities that hold you, the identities that are vital to your being, the places that you call home. Maybe it's just the only thing you have to hold on to are the questions. Whatever it is that brings you groundedness, that brings you comfort, that brings you that spark of life, see if you can sit in some moments of silence and say yes to whatever that is. Let us hold a time of silence together. with no undue haste. Return to this space, shared with those who wish you well. Amen, and blessed be. One of the joys of the silence in this room for me the last couple weeks has been hearing the children and the classes outside. And it reminds me that we gather here not just for ourselves, but for the generations who will follow, for the people who have not yet felt and heard the promises of Unitarian Universalism. So I invite you this morning, whether at home, on your computers, or later, or after the service, for those of you who are here, to give as generously as you can to ensure that the programs that we are working so diligently to keep making happen during the pandemic can keep going for those who follow, for the children who are learning how to figure out their own beliefs, how to be with other people and work with conflict and seek humor and joy and all of the other promises that we make in our covenants. Your generosity helps that continue. So you can write a check and send it to USNH 700 Hartford Turnpike in Hamden, 06517. Hey, look, I remembered that off my top of the head. You can also go to our website, usnh.org, to give there. And after the service, there will be collection plates where you can drop money or check in the back of the sanctuary on your way out. So again, thank you for your generosity. It makes a difference in people's lives and in their living. Thank you.
The reading today comes from Reverend Dr. Samuel Wells. It's entitled Two Important Moments in Improvisation. There are two important moments in improvisation: the moment of formation and then the moment of decision. For example, take Chesley Sullenberger, the pilot who landed in the Hudson River when his plane was hit by a flock of geese. He is a classic improviser. Here he is. He has just taken off from New York with 150 people on board, and the engines go out. I just get chills just repeating this. What does he do? Well, that's not the moment to look for an extraordinary gift of skill. All he can do is fall back on what he has practiced hundreds of times in his training. So he improvises. He's never been in the air before New York and had his engines go out before. He's in a new situation where he has to fall back on the formation that's taken place over decades. So he looks around. He sees the Hudson River and he thinks, I can dip down in there. I might hit something, but it's less of a problem than landing in the middle of Manhattan. I'm going to give it a try. It's a classic moment of improvisation. He's not being spontaneous, clever, or witty, but he is bringing into the moment all of the shaping over a long period of time.
Thank you.
There was once a man who decided to become a Buddhist monk. Upon entering the monastery, he made a vow not to leave until he had learned something significant enough that he could teach it to others to relieve their suffering. So he studied and chanted and meditated diligently. He served his community with humility. He stayed 10 years, then 20. And even though his teachers felt he was ready to re-enter the world, he knew he had not yet fulfilled his vow. Finally, after 30 years, he announced that it was time for him to leave the monastery. Of course, many people in the local village had heard about this monk, and as he exited the gates and began walking away from the temple, a young girl came up and started walking beside him. "So what was it?" she asked. "What was the important thing you learned after 30 years? The monk looked at her and said, "Meet what arrives. Meet what arrives." I had a chance to practice that a few years ago under very different circumstances than a monastery. I was driving on the highway behind a giant truck hauling dirt. And the reason I knew what it was carrying was that the black tarp on top wasn't secured very well. It kept flapping around so much that I could tell that it might fly off at any moment. But I drew on my practice of staying present and just stayed aware of what was going on with the tarp, the other cars around me, and with my speedometer. And sure enough, in a place where that highway goes uphill and around a slight curve, the plastic sheet suddenly came undone. It floated upward for a second and then billowed right towards me. And in that moment, I was completely calm. I was present enough that I noticed how elegantly the material caught the air, flowing like a dancer's skirt. I could tell it was going to land across my windshield and cover my view, so I decided to keep driving and see what would happen. And right after it covered me, it got pulled into the slipstream and whipped right over the car. And when I looked in the rearview mirror, the sheet had dropped to the ground, no longer a danger. About 10 seconds later, I found myself quite a bit shaken by the experience. A combination of adrenaline and, "Oh my God, did that just happen?" kind of careening around my nervous system. And yet I still recognized that if I'd seized up with fear and slammed on the brakes instead of meeting what actually arrived, I could have gotten seriously hurt. That ability to act from presence and instinct, reinforced by practice, is the heart of improvisational theater. As we've heard, improv isn't about being funny or wacky or super quick. It's about being in the moment, using what the other actors have handed you, and then responding organically in a way that advances the scene. A few years ago, just before Stephen Colbert started as the host of The Late Show, GQ ran an interview with him. Did any of you read it? It was quite extraordinary. At one point, Colbert, who's a master of improv, talks about the need to be focused, intentional, and fully present in order to do comedy. The final goal, the product, is beside the point. The end product is jokes, he said, but you could easily say the end product is intention. Having intentionality at all times. The process of process is process. When Colbert first performed improv on stage at Second City in Chicago, their director emphasized the most important lesson he could teach them. You have to learn to love the bomb. It took me a long time to really understand what that meant, Colbert said. It wasn't, "Don't worry, you'll get it next time." It wasn't laugh it off. No, it means what it says. You gotta learn to love when you're failing. The embracing of that The discomfort of failing in front of an audience leads you to penetrate through the fear that blinds you. Fear is the mind killer. He said he trained himself, not just on stage, but every day in life, even in his dream states, to steer toward fear rather than away from it. Samuel Wells, an Anglican priest and theologian who provided today's reading, has written about the parallels between improv and ethics, which for him are about forming a person's character more than judging their actions. While improv seems random, chaotic, and on the edge of crashing, as one person put it, it's actually structured spontaneity, governed by rules and grounded in habit. Actors can approach a range of unknown situations from a place of humor and confidence instead of fear. In any given scene, you've got different choices about how to respond when it's your turn. You could block, you can accept, or you can over-accept. And Wells illustrates these concepts by describing a child jumping out of her seat and running on stage to play a piano, just as a concert pianist enters the stage to perform. In this scenario, the pianist could accept the situation and let the child play. The pianist could block the situation by having security escort the child off stage. Or the pianist could over-accept by sitting down on the bench with the child and playing piano with the child. As Wells puts it, over-accepting imitates the way God operates in the world, because the divine neither blocks what has been created nor tosses away its original material. The over-acceptance folds into the scene and informs what comes next. One of my very favorite improv games, which is all about over-accepting, is called Yes And. The idea is that you're part of a design team coming up with new features for the company's latest product, usually something deliciously ridiculous like an inflatable balloon-powered bicycle or an edible cell phone. So after the first person shares that idea, everyone else applauds and says, "Oh my goodness, that's so brilliant! Totally stupendous!" Then the next person in the circle says, "Yes, and it also has whatever they're tossing into the mix," and so on. Whether the suggestion is hilarious, pedestrian, a total non sequitur, or one of those six impossible things before breakfast, every idea gets cheered. Now, even though I've introduced this game to many groups, I still get surprised by how much difficulty some folks have. You'll hear someone begin, "Yes, but scream!" The word "but" has the effect of negating everything that came before. Others don't trust their instincts or think that their idea is too boring, even though the agreed upon rules mean that everyone gets cheered no matter what. What this game also does, besides helping us work with whatever scenario we're faced with, is to give us practice at holding multiple possibilities at once. That balloon-powered bicycle can have a self-steering navigation system and a disco ball that spins when your hands are on the grips. The edible cell phone can have an antenna made of licorice and operate only when there's enough signal from the local college radio station. Things that may seem like opposites may in fact be independent variables. I can love you from the depths of my heart and be furious with you. One does not negate the other. Improv, like religion, isn't a solo endeavor. It makes its home in communities that, as Wells puts it, are schooled in a tradition so thoroughly that they learn to act from habit in the ways appropriate to the circumstance. The actors come to embody the structures and rules of the improvisational form in a way they can trust. They know that their training will be available to them when they're on stage, even when they're plopped into the middle of challenging situations. He notes that this is exactly the same goal as theological ethics. To be so present in the moment and so steeped in our spiritual values, beliefs, and aspirations that we act from that place without needing to think about it. It's no longer what we do. It's who we are. Ethics is not about being clever in a crisis, he writes, but about forming the character that does not realize it has been in a crisis until the crisis is over. Improvisation is not about being spontaneous and witty in the moment, but about trusting oneself to do and say the obvious. You can trust yourself in the midst of the unknown. Your response becomes obvious because you know who you are. And you can do so in community because you trust the people you're with and the agreements you've made with each other. Our ability as Unitarian Universalists to live into our covenants, those agreements we've made with each other, is something we learn by being in spiritual community. This is where we get to practice being faithful to our values, beliefs, and aspirations. Just as in improv, practice forms skill, skill forms habit, and habit informs instinct and character. Wells writes, "In every moral situation, the real decisions are the ones that have been taken sometime before. To live well requires both effort and habit. There's a place for both. But no amount of effort at the moment of decision will make up for effort neglected in the time of formation." Now, I want to toss in a reminder here that the goal is not perfection. The process of process is process. People will disappoint you. Grief will visit you and your loved ones. You won't always have the answers. Maybe like the game earlier, you'll only have questions. You may not even have those. And so that was not intended for Lisa, just to be clear. It's all good. So when you meet what arrives, though, that's what reduces suffering. Now, you may or may not know that Stephen Colbert is the youngest of 11 children. And when he was 10, his father and two of his brothers, the two closest to him in age, were killed in a plane crash. The older siblings had already left home by then, so it was just him and his mom for years. During that interview, he and the author, Joel Lavelle, eventually come to the question of how he could have suffered such intense losses and yet somehow arrived here. It's not just that he doesn't exhibit any of the anger or open woundedness of so many other comedians. It's that he appears to be so genuinely grounded and joyful. In a very thoughtful response, Colbert talks about learning from his mother's example. She was broken by what had happened, but never bitter. Maybe, he said, she had to be that for him. He has said this before, that even in those days of unremitting grief, she drew on her faith that the only way to not be swallowed by sorrow, to in fact recognize that our sorrow is inseparable from our joy, is to always understand our suffering, ourselves, in the light of eternity. It was a very healthy reciprocal acceptance of suffering, he said, which does not mean being defeated by suffering. Acceptance is not defeat. Acceptance is just awareness. He smiled in anticipation of the callback. "You gotta learn to love the bomb," he said. "Boy, did I have a bomb when I was 10. That was quite an explosion. And I learned to love it. So that's why. Maybe, I don't know. That might be why you don't see me as someone angry and working out my demons on stage. It's that I love the thing that I most wish had not happened. I love the thing that I most wish had not happened. He was 35, he said, before he could really feel the truth of that. He was walking down the street and it stopped me dead. I went, oh, I'm grateful. Oh, I feel terrible. I felt so guilty to be grateful, but I knew it was true. It's not the same thing as wanting it to have happened, he said, but you can't change everything about the world. You certainly can't change things that have already happened. I would add, though, that you can transform their meaning. So what are the bombs that have gone off in this congregation? I know that Reverend Megan's unexpected departure, followed by Reverend John's illness and death, threw people for a major loop. The schism early in USNH's history wove fear of another split into the congregation's DNA. The pandemic and all the accommodations we've had to create have been massively unsettling. I'm sure there are others, but how do we learn not to just grit our teeth and get through these things, but to love them? Actually love them. I really wish I knew how to juggle right now, because it would be such a great illustration of turning anxiety and discomfort into delight, though delight still tinged with risk and the possibility of chaos. The juggler knows that things could fall apart at any time, but she also knows that meeting what arrives allows her to act from what she has spent countless hours practicing. Certainty would only be possible if she left those juggling pins inside a bag, unused. Far more orderly, but way less delightful. This congregation, you and I, are at the beginning of a new chapter right now. But the commitments you've made in the past and the effort you've put into them, using kind language, practicing generosity, pursuing justice, working with conflict, and of course, seeking humor and joy. Those are the decisions that speak to who you are, not just what you do. So let's act from that place of delight rather than fear, that place of presence and love and gratitude and meaning and risk rooted in well-trained instincts. And may we find plenty of laughter along the way. Amen, and blessed be.
Days remembered burns a beacon bright and clear, guiding hands and hearts and spirits into faith set free from fear. When the fire of commitment sets our mind and soul ablaze, when our hunger and our passion meet to call us on our way, when we live with deep assurance of the flame that burns within, then our promise finds fulfillment and our futures can begin. The stories of our living rings a song both brave and free, calling pilgrims still to witness to the life of liberty. When the fire of commitment sets our mind and soul ablaze, when our hunger and our passion need to call us
us on our way. When we live with deep assurance of the flame that burns within, then our promise finds fulfillment and our future can begin. From the dreams of youthful vision comes a new prophetic voice, which demands a deeper justice built by our courageous choice. When the fire of commitment sets our mind and soul ablaze, when our hunger and our passion seek to call us on our way, when we live with deep assurance of the flame that burns within, then our promise finds fulfillment and our future can begin.
We are at the time of the service where we now extinguish our chalice. But I just have to tell you how grateful I am to be with all of you. Now, before we extinguish the chalice, I was asked to make this announcement. We need to gather outside after the service for conversation and coffee. We really hope that we can get your cooperation in building this place as a safe place for worship. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of a community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Friends, we know who we are. We know the world we want to build. We know the world we want our children to live in and to help build a future in. Let us go steeped in this Unitarian Universalist tradition that helps us with our living, to be the change that we want, to live in a way that creates that world that we aspire to. Let us go with courage and with kindness, and be a blessing to this world. Amen.